welcome to Up South, your one-stop destination for a comprehensive look at all the top news stories of the day from South India. I'm T.S. Sudhir, and finally some cause for cheer for Visakhapatnam. The city's battered airport, pummeled into submission by cyclone Hudhud on Sunday, will finally reopen tomorrow with the first flight landing from New Delhi in the afternoon and then taking off for Hyderabad.
You see, we are, Air India is restoring tomorrow flights from here to Hyderabad and Delhi. So this is good. It's a step in the right direction and it's happening. We are happy about it. Visakhapatnam is an important town for our country. It has, it's an important port city of also. We handle the most amount of cargo in tonnage in the country. And I think a town like this deserves a functional airport. So we have to go and we have to do it.
It is of course great news for Visakhapatnam and India, because just after 3-4 days of the cyclone Hudhud hitting Visakhapatnam and completely reducing its airport to rubble, the airport is now ready to spring back to its feet with the first Air India flight flying tomorrow from Delhi to Visakhapatnam and from Visakhapatnam to Hyderabad. Subsequently, day after tomorrow, about 9 flights will be made functional and they will fly from the Visakhapatnam airport. The officials say that it will take about 1 month for restoration and repair work to happen, and it will take about 3 to 4 months for the civil terminal to start functioning and all the services made available for the passengers here. So the Visakhapatnam airport, from being a symbol of destruction, will now become the symbol of hope and resilience. With camera person Manohar Reddy, Ratnika Sharma in Visakhapatnam for Headlines Today.
Joining me now from Visakhapatnam is former Energy Secretary to the Government of India, Mr. E.S. Sharma, also a prominent Visagite. Mr. Sharma, thanks a lot for joining us on Up South on Headlines Today. You must be what has become to your very beautiful city. But talking about the airport, which has become a symbol of the destruction of Visakhapatnam, did it surprise you that it was aerodynamically so unsuitable for an airport built in a coastal city like Visakhapatnam?
Yes, I was really surprised, because in the United States, San Francisco is a city which sits on a very severe earthquake fault line. But they have designed all buildings for that, you know, to withstand earthquakes, and there is nothing, no worry at all. So in a city like Visakhapatnam, two things are important. One is aerodynamic stability, the other is corrosion. Because of the seawater and the salinity, they should design everything which is anti-corrosive, basically. So I am really, you know, I think this is a very important lesson learned from this Hudhud cyclone. They should now look at all the coastal structures and see whether any design changes are required. And I think that is an important lesson. I would say that I hope we learn the lesson.
Right, Mr. Sharma, stay on with us. We will be discussing other aspects of this entire destruction caused by the cyclone in Visakhapatnam. But we have been bringing you images from the ground. Now, let's get you some aerial images. Ratnika Sharma and camera person Manohar Reddy actually went on a relief sortie and brought you these images of distress and despair.
Presently carrying 300 food packets to be dropped in Rambilli Mandalam. There are 7 villages. We are some of the villages we have seen have been evacuated. We got the information from district administration to provide this food package to all the villages who are stranded, and no relief material is able to come by the road due to road blockages.
As we fly across villages in the Rambilli Mandal, officers are trying to see which is the best place to drop the food and water supply. Also, because of a lot of turbulence in this area, The aircraft had to hover for a while before they could decide on a place as to where to drop the food and water packets. And as you can see, people eagerly waiting. The hour and a half long aerial survey to assess the impact of Cyclone Hudhud over the city of Visakhapatnam began from the naval dockyard to see what the kind of damage was done there, and then it went on towards Kailashgiri, where the eye of the storm had actually passed when the cyclone had hit Visakhapatnam. And most importantly, it ended in the Rambilli Mandal, where about 7 villages were just cut off from any kind of access of food and water because of the floods that had followed the cyclone Hudhud. And after that, they were also blocked because of the fact that a lot of trees had fallen and all the roads were blocked, where the aircraft actually dropped food and water supplies. And that's how the entire survey, the aerial survey, took place, along with 2 IAS officers also in the aircraft who were there to assess the impact of Cyclone Hudhud. About 55 IAS officers have been deployed only for Visakhapatnam city to assess the relief and rehabilitation after Cyclone Hudhud hit Visakhapatnam city. With cameraperson Manohar Reddy, Ratnika Sharma and Visakhapatnam from Headlines Today.
Mr. A.S. Sharma still with us. Mr. Sharma, what do you reckon, how many years has Visakhapatnam been pushed back by because of the destruction caused by the cyclone?
In terms of greenery lost, I think it's about 10 years. It will take about 10 years for Vizag to get back its greenery, which is completely destroyed. But otherwise, I think Vizag is quite resilient. It will come back to its original self. People are extremely enterprising. I have absolutely no doubt about that. Within 1 year, I think Vizag will be back.
Mr. Sharma, you have also been very critical of the VVIP visits to Visakhapatnam in the last 5 days. Why do you think the VIP visits actually do not serve any purpose?
Let me first say that I am very happy that the Chief Minister, Mr. Chandrababu Naidu, is camping here and is reviewing all the things. I welcome that, because after all, he is the elected head of the state government. But I certainly object to people like the governor, even the Prime Minister, coming and doing an aerial survey. What really happens is, officers who are supposed to run the departments, they were all busy trying to answering questions. Actually, officers should be answerable to the people of this city. The governor, for example, need not have come at all. And the Chief Minister would have seen all the pictures. He need not do an aerial survey. And Ms. Chandrababu Naidu could have briefed the Prime Minister on telephone. He would have given all the information. I have handled many, many such situations in the government. The last tidal wave in Krishna district long ago, I found that whenever these VIPs come here, one, there is tremendous pressure on vehicles, which are required by the people. You know, I have come across one case where somebody has booked a taxi for going to the hospital, and the taxi was not allowed to because this taxi was requisitioned for the VIPs who are coming here. The people who are on duty around the VIPs, all the officers camping here. So from that point of view. And the second thing is, I think they should allow the district administration to work. You know, I was surprised that when you knew that a huge cyclone like this was approaching Visakhapatnam, there was no commissioner of police, regular commissioner of police. There was no commissioner of municipal corporation. There was no vice chairman of the Visakhapatnam Urban Development Authority.
Right. Mr. Sharma, stay on with us. In fact, the official estimate of the losses because of the cyclone is almost 70,000 crore rupees, a staggering 70,000 crore rupees. In fact, the Indian Navy, which has its eastern naval base in Visakhapatnam, has itself lost about 2,000 crore rupees. My colleague Jugal Purohit and camera person Nikhil Sharma sent us this report from the eastern naval base.
The dreaded cyclone Hudhud not only devastated property, infrastructure, flora and fauna and the pristine beaches of the port city, but also battered the second largest naval base in the country. The Indian Navy has suffered an estimated loss of 2,000 crore rupees due to the severe cyclonic storm in Visakhapatnam.
The untold story of the damage and devastation in the wake of Cyclone Hudhud lies on the other side of Visakhapatnam town. I am standing right now in front of the naval dockyard, which houses the most potent assets of the Eastern Naval Command, India's second largest naval command. Even though most of the warships were sailed out well in time before the cyclone could make its impact, there is tremendous damage inside. sources tell us that in terms of communication, connectivity, networks, infrastructure, the Navy has sustained losses of well over 2,000 crore rupees.
Operations at the crucial Eastern Naval Command were hit with damage to the Naval Base, Naval Air Base INS Dega, and residential quarters at the Dolphin Nose Hill. But warships were able to withstand its impact.
We had warning of almost 5 days. We are fully prepared. We are manning. But wind force of 210 kilometers per hour, most of the old structures just could not withstand.
Also, naval sailor S. Sawant lost his life on the 12th of October while on duty. With the damage suffered by Cyclone Hudhud, it would take weeks for Andhra Pradesh's largest city to get back on its feet after the unprecedented blow. With Jugal Purohit in Visakhapatnam, Bureau Report, Headlines Today.
Mr. Sharma, finally, do you reckon that brand Visakhapatnam has taken a huge hit? How difficult will it be for the city to now attract investment?
Let me be very frank with you. When you say brand Visakhapatnam, what is this brand? I always questioned it. There are about 50-60 slums where people live in sub-Saharan conditions. I mean, it's a filth. They have no shelter of worth the name. They live in small coconut-covered tents. They have no doors. Because they don't have doors, there are no door numbers. They don't get IDs, electoral IDs. And they are the people who really run the city, because they sell vegetables, they sell fruits, and they do daily wage work. They supply carpentry services, electrician services. Now, when we talk of those, when people talk of a brand, what is this brand? Is it the brand represented by the slums, or the brand represented by shiny buildings like HSBC and all these buildings which are glass encased and all? I think we must wake up our mind. I think if at all the brand Visakhapatnam has to improve, I think this government should really go to the slums and try to elevate the living conditions of those people in those areas.
Right, Mr. A.S. Sharma, thanks a lot for your perspective there from Visakhapatnam. We do hope that the city actually gets back to normal pretty soon. We will continue to track all the developments in Vizag very, very closely. Now, news from Karnataka. Now, the state's Lingayat spiritual head, Mate Mahadevi, has invited the wrath of women's activists as she criticized girls wearing skimpy clothes. She believes that Western culture and clothing have resulted in increased incidents of rape. In fact, she has also urged the government to legalize prostitution to curb the menace.
ಇಂತ ಪರಿಸ್ಥಿತಿಯಲ್ಲಿ ಸಿಕ್ಕಾಪಟ್ಟೆ ಮನಸ್ಸಿನ ವಿಕಾರಗಳನ್ನು ಕೆರಳಿಸುವಂತ ಬಟ್ಟೆಗಳನ್ನ ಇವತ್ತೇನು ಹಾಕೊಳ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ. ಇದು ಭಾರತೀಯ ಸಂಸ್ಕೃತಿಗೆ ವಿರುದ್ಧ. ಇದನ್ನ ಖಂಡಿತ ಹೆಣ್ಣು ಮಕ್ಕಳು ಬಿಡಬೇಕು. ಇದು ಒಳ್ಳೇದಲ್ಲ. ಅದರಿಂದ ಅಂತ ಒಂದು ಪ್ರಚೋದನೆಗಳಾಗಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಅವಕಾಶ ಇರುತ್ತೆ. ಸಭ್ಯವಾದ ರೀತಿಯಲ್ಲಿ ಬಟ್ಟೆ ಹಾಕೋದನ್ನ ಭಾರತೀಯ ಸಂಸ್ಕೃತಿ ಪ್ರಕಾರ ಅಳವಡಿಸ್ಕೋಬೇಕು ಅಂತಾನೆ ನಮ್ಮ ಸ್ಪಷ್ಟ ಅಭಿಪ್ರಾಯ. ಮೈ ಮುಚ್ಚು ಅಂತ ಬಟ್ಟೆ ಹಾಕಬೇಕು. ಯಾವ ಬಟ್ಟೆ ಅಂತಲ್ಲ, ಮೈ ಮುಚ್ಚು ಅಂತ ಬಟ್ಟೆಗಳನ್ನ ಹಾಕಬೇಕೇ ಹೊರತು ಅಂಗಾಂಗ ಪ್ರದರ್ಶನ ಮಾಡುವಂತ ಬಟ್ಟೆಗಳನ್ನ ಹಾಕೋಬಾರ್ದು. ವೇಷಾವೃತ್ತಿ ಮಾತ್ರ ನಡೆದೇ ನಡೀತದೆ, ಅದನ್ನ ಯಾರೂ ತಪ್ಪಿಸಕ್ಕಾಗಲ್ಲ. ಅದು ಮನುಷ್ಯನ ಹಲವಾರು ದೌರ್ಬಲ್ಯಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ಒಂದಿರೋದ್ರಿಂದ ಸಮಾಜದಲ್ಲಿ ಅದು ನಡೀತದೆ. ಒಂದು ಬಡತನದ ಕಾರಣದಿಂದ ಆಗ್ಬೋದು, ಬಡತನದ ಕಾರಣದಿಂದ ವೇಷಾವೃತ್ತಿ ಆಗ್ಬೋದು. ಇನ್ನೊಂದು, ಮದುವೆ ಆಗಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಇವತ್ತು ಸಮಸ್ಯೆಗಳು ವಿಪರೀತ ಆಗೋಗಿದ್ದಾವೆ. ವರದಕ್ಷಿಣೆ ಕಾನೂನು ಅದು ಇದು ಇವೆಲ್ಲ ಸಮಸ್ಯೆಗಳು. ಈ ಎಲ್ಲ ಸಮಸ್ಯೆಗಳಿಂದ ನಿಸ್ಸಹಾಯಕರಾದ ಮಹಿಳೆಯರು ವೇಷಾವೃತ್ತಿಯನ್ನು ಮಾಡಬಹುದು. ಆದ್ದರಿಂದ ಅವರಿಗೆ ಅದನ್ನು ಅಧಿಕೃತಗೊಳಿಸಿ ಅವರಿಗೆ ವೈದ್ಯಕೀಯ ಸೌಲಭ್ಯಗಳನ್ನು ಮುಂತಾದನ್ನೆಲ್ಲ ಕೊಟ್ಟರೆ ಅವರ ಜೀವನಕ್ಕೂ ಒಳ್ಳೆಯದಾಗಬಹುದು, ಮತ್ತು ಅಂಥ ವೃತ್ತಿಗೆ ನೆರವು ನೀಡುವಂಥ ಪುರುಷರಿಗೂ ಸಮಸ್ಯೆಗಳು ಕಾಯಿಲೆಗಳು ಕಡಿಮೆ ಆಗ್ಬೋದು ಅಂತ ನಮ್ಮ ಅಭಿಪ್ರಾಯ.
ದಿಸ್ ಕೈಂಡ್ ಆಫ್ ರಿಮಾರ್ಕ್ ಇಸ್ ಆಕ್ಚುಲಿ ಅನ್ ಇನ್ಸ್ಟೆನ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ರೇಪ್ ಕಲ್ಚರ್. Rape culture means the culture that justifies rape, that blames rape on women, and therefore it actually encourages and continuously produces rape. Which is why I think that one should not single this remark out alone. So I think that we all need to speak out really loudly against these views and resist this idea and hold rapists responsible for rape and rape culture responsible for rape, not women responsible for rape.
I have already earlier said that it is very regrettable that people who are in public life make these very irresponsible statements. I think the lady has merely given excuses to people who commit such bad crimes to say that, you know, even a spiritual guru has said it. So how can you blame us if we are tempted by girls who are wearing Western clothes? I think maybe she did not mean badly, but they should think twice before they make these statements.
Joining me now from Bangalore is my colleague Pratibha Raban, who has been reporting on the story. Pratibha, what have been the reactions to the seer's very controversial comments from within Karnataka?
Well, Sudhir, considering that most people believe that Bangalore as well as Karnataka seems to be a very progressive state, a comment like this has invited a lot of wrath among Bangaloreans, especially the women community here, who seem to think that such a statement is quite insensitive. And considering that quite a few politicians too, even before this seer made this comment about legalizing prostitution, in fact today we confronted Mr. K.G. George, who's the home minister of the state, and he did mention that such a discussion hasn't taken place. But if at all many of them do come up with this, it will be discussed in the government today. Sudhir.
Staying with news from Karnataka, an IAS officer, Rashmi V. Mahesh, faced the ire of an angry mob in Mysore on Wednesday. She's the director general of the Administrative Training Institute, and she was roughed up by relatives of an employee in the same institute because he was found dead in a sump inside the ATI on Wednesday. The group attacked the IAS officer, claiming that the deceased committed suicide due to irregularities at the institute. 19 people have reportedly been arrested in the case.
Also, the police commissioner of Mysore is already suspended. One sub-inspector is supposed to take care of that situation. He didn't do it. And the body has been sent back to the institution. But this is the wrong thing he has done. And also, the inquiry has conducted against the circle inspector also. And 18 people has been arrested so far on. We are taking very serious and severe action with those people. Also.
That's it then on Up South this Thursday evening. Thanks for watching. News and updates will continue on Headlines Today.